Professor Javier Gomez Mo, he talks about the generation of the Cremona map with application to pencils of curve and pollution in CP2.
Okay, thank you very much. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me and for organizing these events, which are very helpful for Mexican algebraic geometry. And so, algebraic geometry makes advances in opening new frontiers, like we have seen in several of the talks that we have had, and also in deepening our understanding of classical themes. So, and also by interplay between algebra and geometry, so it's really a wonderful place to work in. And this talk will circle around topics in classical algebraic geometry. I'm not opening any new frontiers. We'll speak about something very classical. And it's something that I had been wondering about, in the sense that a birational map moves things from certain degree to a bigger degree, but they are essentially the same because they're moved by a birational map, but the degree increased. So in some sense I wanted to understand this this thing. And so, in particular, I'm going to apply it to polynomial vector fields and birational transformations in two variables. So, the Cremona map is a very simple map, which in affine coordinates can be written as phi of x1, x2 is 1 over x1, 1 over x2. And so this means that it's outside of the axis, it's an involution, and in projective coordinates is a map which is written via quadratic functions. And so it's a birational involution of the complex projective plane. And in this research, I have been carrying it together with Christian Brunati from Dijon, Gallegos from Madrid, and Gonzalez Villa from CIMAT. And we're interested in trying to understand the effect that this transformation has in pencils of curves, in foliation by curves, and what we call the regeneration. So, geometrically, this Cremona map, so if we call delta zero the triangle formed by the three axes with the line at infinity, and vertices the intersection of the three axes, then the Cremona map is a map defined on CP2 minus the three vertices, and it sends this line into this point, this line into this point, and this line into this other point. So it's a transformation which is contracting three lines and is not defined on three points. Now, if we blow up the three points, these three vertices, and we consider the strict transforms of these lines, we get an hexagon, and then we can contract the old lines, and so the Cremona map can be resolved by means of this transformation. So is this map, which is blow up, this map is also blow up, and so it's just, so that's the Cremona map. Now, we'd like to understand how a Cremona transformation transforms a smooth curve C of degree D. So, we all know that the genus is the topological invariant of a curve of degree D, and its genus is given by D minus 1 times D minus 2 over 2. And here I am writing the coefficients of the curve, of the equations of the curve, in its Newton polygon. So it's these ones. And now if I write the equation of phi inverse of C, then I have to put, instead of the y's, I put y to the minus 1, y to the minus 2. So I gather coefficients, and it turns out to be this is the equation of the transformed curve. Now, if I look in this Newton diagram where are the non-zero coefficients, it turned out that this triangle got reflected along the diagonal, but so now we don't have terms over here, and we have terms in this part over here, and so this curve became now of degree 2D. So a curve of degree D became a curve of degree 2D when we apply this Cremona transformation, and here are the non-vanishing coefficients. So to regenerate the singularity at zero of the Cremona transformation means to fill in these terms over here, to put non-zero terms. The fact that the original Cremona transformation had zeros over here implies that it has a strong singularity at zero. And if I also put non-zero terms over here, then I am also non-singularizing the two points at infinity, where the two vertices at infinity where we have the singularities. So to regenerate the Cremona transform of a smooth curve means to fill up these terms over here. Now, so in geometric terms, so that's in algebraic terms, in geometric terms, then a generic curve in the plane will intersect transversely the three lines. So in D points. So this is the general curve intersecting this triangle where we're doing the Cremona transformation. And if we want to view it over the complex numbers, then this will be the Riemann surface. And we have D points which are marked because they are intersecting these three lines, and this is the genus of the curve. And now when we do the Cremona transform of the curve C, then the points which intersected the line, so each of these D points are going to be contracted to one of the vertices. And then one of the vertices, and we have a birational map on the complement. So what we get is a curve that has now three singular points, these three singular points, and outside is the same curve. So I just collapse the lines, and since there were three D points intersecting each line transversely, I get a singularity that has D lines. The tangent cone consists of D lines. So when I regenerate each of the critical points, what will happen is that some genus is going to be coming out of the singularity, and so this I do simultaneously at the three points, and now I get a smooth curve of degree 2D. So I had one of degree D, I did the Cremona transform, I made three singular points, outside I did nothing, and then when I regenerate, then these three singular points, I make a smoothening of them. Now, I will have to convince you of the following picture, which I think is somehow surprising. It's the following. So first, a numerical thing. G tilde is the genus of the curve of degree 2D, and G is the genus of the curve of degree D. So I'm going to write G minus 4G. I want to convince you that this curve will be formed by a main body and by three pulgas. I don't know how you say pulgas in English. Three fleas. And so these fleas, I will be squeezing them. And so they will be squeezed. So these fleas are going to be squeezed. These are the Riemann surfaces which are coming out with the singularities. So the claim is that it will be another Riemann surface of the same genus as the main body, G. And it's going to have, each one is going to have deconnecting tubes. So look at this computation. G tilde, which is 2D minus 1 times 2D minus 2 over 2, minus 4G, which are the four bodies. So I subtract them. And then you do some elementary calculation, and it becomes 3D minus 1. So this means that you are adding 3 these are tubes of D tubes which correspond to D minus 1 genes. Now, you might say, where did I get this picture from? So I'm going to try to regenerate the Cremona map to see you that this picture is correct. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to separate the main body with the three satellites, and then the claim is that when I move the parameter, these satellites will be collapsing each one to each of the singular points, and the main body will be the curve that's the Cremona transform of the curve. So the Cremona transform phi zero induces a map from the space of curves of degree d to the space of curves of degree 2d, and so this so sending the equation to this to the transformed equation, and so now all these curves, as we saw, the generic one has three singular points. The generic curve of degree 2d is smooth, and so we want to understand how a point over here, when we move it over, it transforms. Now, in the case of curves, it's simple because one knows that since Euler and Gauss, that the topology of an oriented compact surface is characterized by the genus. When we do this for foliations, which is not clear what's the topological description of the foliations, it will be more interesting. So the dilemma we will show is the following. So let's see be a smooth curve of degree d in CP2 that intersects transversely this triangle, and we're going to construct a smooth surface with a projection map to C in such a way that it's going to be a fiber bundle over C minus zero by smooth curves of degree 2d, and then when we arrive at zero, it's going to consist of the following picture. Here we're going to have CP2, and here we have CP2 blown up at three points. Here we will have a copy of the original curve, and here will be a copy of the original curve but blown up at the three points. If the three points were not on the curve, they do nothing. And this curve are going to intersect in the D points of the line they have in common. And so this means that this curve over here is going to have 3D points, ordinary double points, and the vertical ones will have D vertical points. And so I want to show that that this is a way to resolve the singularities of the Cremona transform. So in some sense, these singularities that were D lines, singularity having D tangent cone D lines, is better understood by this semi-stable curve. So in some sense, all the vertical curves are collapsed into the points, and this is a better way to understand what's happening. So I have to convince you that this is a correct image. And if I convince you that this is a correct image, then when I put on this family pi 1 instead of, this is the inverse image of 0, I put the inverse image of epsilon, I will have something which is here like the original curve, which at each of these intersections will have the tubes, and then here we have the original curve, and here we have the other copies, and here in the intersection, instead of having these ordinary double points, we have some tubes. And then you can see from this picture that the image I was telling you is correct, and then if I blow down everything, then you see that these components become very small, and so they are the fleece, because they are becoming very small, and the one which is horizontal is the one which is surviving. Now, so So I'm going to do simultaneous. See, I explain this case of curves because I think it's simpler to understand. The case of foliation, which is really the one I'm interested in, is more difficult to understand. So if you understood this, then you're going to go next step. So any question? Is this clear? Okay, so now, what's a foliation by curves in CP2? Algebraically, they are defined by polynomial 1 forms. So you give a polynomial 1 form here of degree D. So they describe a one-dimensional distribution. So if you take the kernel of omega at each point, they describe a one-dimensional distribution of the tangent space. And by the theorem of existence and uniqueness of holomorphic differential equations, its solutions give rise to local analytic curves tangent to the distribution, and globally giving rise to a decomposition of the space into a disjoint union of curves. Now these curves are locally analytic curves which may have recurrence. So they are not algebraic. Even if the differential equation is algebraic, these are locally analytic curves, but they may are embedded in projective space. So this is an example of what I think of a foliation. This is foliation by two-dimensional leaves. Now one should think, which is the thing I'm thinking, is that the leaves, there's recurrence in the leaves, so they are coming very often back. So they, in particular, they are non-algebraic. And the foliation will have singularities where the differential form vanishes. So it's actually a non-singular foliation in CP2 minus the singular points. The generic singularity may be linearized. So it means that at the singular points, this is a local model. And the solutions are obtained just by taking the exponential. So this means that you have the two axes are going to be solutions. And then these other leaves are accumulating on both of these axes in a way like this exponential. And generic is when alpha 1 is not a real number. And so this gives a picture of what a foliation looks like. And then an important concept in foliation is this thing about the holonomy pseudogroup. So holonomy pseudogroup means that you're going to transport, so you have these local flow boxes, and so at every non-singular point you have local flow boxes, so you take a path in a leaf, and you go from one flow box to the other, and so these are defined by submersions, and so you have the composition of the images of the submersions, and this is the holonomy map, and so this is telling you how the leaves are behaving when you in nearby leaves when you move along a path in a leaf. So that's the holonomy pseudogroup. Now we may consider in CP2 minus the singularities of omega the following substructures of the foliation. One is topological. To think that you have a topological foliation by topological surfaces, so you forget the complex structure of the leaves and just think of the object topologically. In this sense, the equivalence in this category is just by homeomorphisms. You can think that you have a differentiable foliation by Riemann surfaces, which means that you're remembering that each leaf is a Riemann surface. Or you can think that you have a differentiable foliation where the differentiable surfaces are grouped in a holomorphic manner. So this means that you are remembering that the pseudogroup is holomorphic, but you are forgetting about the complex structure of the leaves. So the foliation is a mixture of different kinds of structures. You can think it in the topological category. You can think it as a foliation by Riemann surfaces, or you can think it as a foliation by differentiable surfaces, but they are grouped in a holomorphic manner. This means that the holonomy pseudogroup is of conformal transformations. So when I think of a foliation in CP2, I think of something like this. There are the singularities. Here you have the leaves, and usually leaves, I think, are dense. The following notion. An unfolding of a foliation F in CP2, it will be a holomorphic family of foliations, FT, such that there is a foliation G in the product space in C cross CP2 with singularities, which have the leaves of dimension 2, in such a way that every time you restrict the variable T, you get the given foliation. So there is this. So a family of foliations will be just a family of one forms in CP2 omega sub T. But now this, so these are given by this A1, A2. Now if you put an additional A1 of T, Y1, Y2, DT, so as to make it a one form in this three-dimensional manifold, and you put the integrability condition so that you get a two-dimensional foliation, then you say that the foliations FT are glued together as an unfolding. So if you have a foliation, when you deform it, the image can change drastically. I mentioned that fortunately for curves, if you have a smooth curve of genus G and you deform it a little bit, it's still a curve of genus G. Now, if you have a foliation and you deform it a little bit, the picture might change completely. Now, if you put this condition that it's not just any deformation, but it's an unfolding, then there are many properties which remain from one to the other. And so this is the technical condition is this, and the fact is the following. So imagine here you have this transversal, is this T equal constant, and so you have a curve which is approaching this, and so you have the holonomy map corresponding to this limit over here. Now, if I change the parameter T and move it over here, then the holonomy map of the two-dimensional foliation of the leaf of dimension 2 is the same for this loop than for this loop. And so in some sense, they have the same holonomy maps. When you have foliations which are one is an unfolding of the other, they have the same holonomy groups. Except, so in an unfolding G, the holonomy pseudogroups of FT and FS coincide for T minus S small, except at the singularities or at the vertical tangencies. So if the foliation is coming in transverse to the verticals, then it's the same holonomy. So the only place where the holonomy can change is at the singularities or at the tangencies. If FT has only hyperbolic singularities, and then any unfolding is by holomorphically trivial. So this means that, you cannot have vertical tangencies because the vertical tangencies will give rise to a singularity which is not hyperbolic. And so there are no vertical tangencies, and then since you have hyperbolic singularities, the holonomy is preserved when you move, and so one can prove this result. Now, so that's about foliation. So the space of foliations of degree D in CP2 form a projective space given by considering the coefficients of its defining form. For the case of curve, we only had one, but here in the case of one form, we have two. The A's and the B's, and here we have them less than or equal to D. When we do this Cremona transform, then the equation will be, here you change to the minus I, minus J, now the differential changes in this form, so you cancel the poles, and now you look at which are the coefficients which are left, and now you have these two triangles. But now the thing went up to degree 2D. And so in some sense, this foliation of degree D, you converted it into a foliation of degree 2D, but it's almost the same because in the complement of these three lines, it's a biholomorphism. So you only put three additional singularities, and so these are the coefficients. Now, to regenerate the Cremona transform of these foliations means to feel in the stars, you feel in coefficients. When you feel in these two, then you're making non-singular the zero point. You're making it in a point in a generic point. So it means that several singularities are going to come out, and then this other at the two points at infinity. But if you do this, if you do this, this changes the topological type. So instead, we want to fill in the coefficients so that the perturbed will still be an unfolding, so it will remember many things of the original foliation, but now we want the singularities to be of multiplicity one. So we want to see if this foliation, which has these three difficult singular points, can be perturbed in such a way that it is an unfolding, so we have this two-dimensional foliation in the parameter, and so the same holonomy groups, except that the singularities where we are allowing something to happen at the singularities. So, applying the Cremona transformation, we obtain an injective map which goes from foliations of degree d to foliations of degree 2d plus 1. So d plus 1 was because we also transformed the differential form. So in that sense, the image has the complexity given by a general foliation over here, but one should expect that this one should be more complicated than the other one. So we want to understand where is the complication. So we want to do the same thing we did before. We have these horrible singular points, three horrible singular points, and we want to make this unfolding, and so something will appear, as in the other case that there was this...
Fleas.
These fleas coming out of the singular point. We want to understand which kind of fleas come out of the singular point, but from a foliation. It's another kind of fleas, and it's not clear what's going to come out. So one would expect a foliation of degree 2d plus 1 to be much more complicated than the foliation of degree d. But since phi 0 is birational, it is essentially the same, with the exception of having three new singular points due to the contraction of the triangle d and the appearance of three new solutions, which are these new lines that we made by blowing up, corresponding to the exceptional divisors. One would like to perturb phi 0 star 0 of omega to obtain a foliation of degree 2d plus 1, but with simpler singular points, say, on multiplicity 1. One would also like to preserve much of the structure far from the singular points, and this can be carried out by this process of unfolding. Now, the group PGL3C of biholomorphic changes of coordinates acts on the space of foliation just by changes of coordinates, leaving invariant the image of this Cremona map. It's an invariant subspace. And the orbits of a point under this, the action of this group, is the biholomorphic equivalence class of a foliation. So the same foliation is biholomorphically represented in projective space by the action of the projective group. Now, we have other equivalents here in this space. One of them is topological equivalence. We say that two foliations are equivalent if there is a homeomorphism sending one to the other. We say that it's transversely holomorphic equivalent if we have a homeomorphism which is conformal in the transversal, transversally to the foliation. And we have also an equivalence which means an unfolding equivalent. We say that two of them are equivalent if there is an unfolding which goes from one to the other. So we have these different kinds of equivalence. The stronger one, of course, is the biholomorphic equivalence, is the action of the group. So the theorem we have for this is the following. So for a foliation in CP2 with hyperbolic singularities, biholomorphic and transversely holomorphic, or biholomorphic and unfolding, equivalence coincide. So the orbits of the group is the same as the equivalence of if you put unfolding or if you put transversely holomorphic. So that's why I left doing this research when I discovered this fact many years ago, because you know it's an exceptional thing to be in an unfolding. But now I'm going to show you that even if it's exceptional, So for foliation, which are Cremona transforms, so this is for the so the general one, the equivalence unfolding or transversely holomorphic is just the action of the group. But for foliation, which are in the Cremona transform, so this means in this projective space, unfolding equivalence has at least one more dimension than by holomorphic equivalence. So I want to show that all of these foliations, which are corresponding to these ones, they have a non-trivial unfolding, which is not a biholomorphic change of coordinate. So in that sense, the equations described by these and the equations which are unfolding are more or less the same, except that something happened at the singularities. Now, if omega has hyperbolic singularities, so this is in here, then the unfolding of this Cremona transform will have hyperbolic singularities and Morse type first integrals. So the only new singularities that will appear besides hyperbolic is holomorphic first integrals. It's Morse type functions. So now let me explain, as I explained the case before for curves, let me explain what is going to happen for foliations. So I still have not told you how I get this picture of having a copy of CP2 blown up at the 3 points and three projective spaces. Now, I have this foliation over there, so I'm going to put a copy of the foliation here, a copy of the foliation here, a copy of the foliation here, and a copy of the foliation here. I'm going to have four copies of the foliation. And at these points, where so this is where the line, this line of the original triangle, where the foliation is transverse, I will put one over here and then another one over here. So it's a foliation that is on this singular variety that is, so it has ordinary double points at each point of intersection, okay? And so when I'm going to make the smoothening of this thing, what will happen is that at each one of these points, there will be a neck coming out and a singular, like a Morse type function that xy equal to 0 goes to xy equal to epsilon. So this means that the foliation will intersect this line in a countable number of points. Now, I'm going to put another one also intersecting at this countable number of points. Now, at each point of intersection, I'm going to construct a neck. I'm going to transform the ordinary double point into a neck, inducing more topology. So I'm increasing the first homology group because I'm putting a neck where I have this. And so the leaf, so if I have a leaf in the original foliation, it will consist of four copies of the original leaf, and then at each one of these points of intersection with the line, I'll have a neck. So the topology of the foliation, the topology of the leaves changed very much. And the thing that the holonomy group is the same as this one over here and over here is what makes it possible to glue these together in an unfolding. So this picture I will perturb, and instead of having it over here, I will have it here in CP2, and so this will be the regeneration of the Cremona transform. And then actually, all this thing is what's coming out of the singularities. So in the other case, what came out of the singularities was another copy of this of the same curve. Now what will come out are three copies of the same foliation. But now let me explain how I get this picture. So this is more or less like a picture. So the foliation GT is obtained by smoothening the ordinary singularities of the leaves of this foliation G0 with annulus, having trivial holonomy along this annulus, and the holonomy group of the four copies is the same. So as a corollary, the topology of the leaves of the FT is much more complicated than the topology of the leaves of the original foliation, but they have equivalent pseudogroups. So now let me explain how I get this image. ¿Cómo vamos de tiempo? ¿Eh?
Fine.
¿Cinco minutos? ¿O? ¿Eh? Ten, okay. So now let me explain you how I get this picture. So I'm going to regenerate the Cremona map. So what does this mean? It means that I'm going to consider the family of maps given by T, that's a parameter, so I have x0 plus x1, and then I'm going to put plus tx2 squared, plus tx1 squared, plus tx0 squared. So this is a family of maps that for t different from 0 is a 4 to 1 map. So for t different from 0, I have a 4 to 1 map, and then when I arrive at t equal to 0, it becomes a birational map, which is not defined at 3 points. So in that sense, you might say, if it's a 4 to 1, and then I take t equals to 0 and it becomes birational, you might say, what happened to the other 3 points? If it was 4 to 1, and now it's 1 to 1. So what happened to the other 3? Well, the other 3, each one is a copy of CP2 in one of the critical points. That's the point. That's why I have to convince you that this image is correct, and that's why what's coming out of the singularity is another copy of the same geometric object that we had before. So this map phi sub t is branching along a smooth elliptic curve for t different from 0 that we call delta t. So this is this image of this delta t. The image, so the branch locus, will be a sextic curve which has 9 cusps, so this I'm putting in this as this rays over here, and so phi t is a map which goes from delta t to dt, so from the branch locus to the branching divisor, this is the normalization of this map. This has 9 cusps, and if I take the inverse image of this thing over here, I get 2 times the elliptic curve plus another dt prime, and this dt prime is another sextic with 9 cusps, and so this is the figure. This is the understanding of how the branching is of the mapping phi t. One has to understand how phi t is branching. When I tend t to 0, all these curves tend to the 3 lines. And so this map, so what I do is the following. So I consider the map which is goes C cross CP2 minus 0 cross the 3 points where it's not defined into CP2 by just projecting into X0, X1, X2. So phi is this map. This is the Cremona, the regularization of the Cremona map is this map over here. And now what I do is I blow up, so this map is a holomorphic map that is not defined at 3 points, so I blow up the 3 points. But I blow them up in a 3-dimensional manifold. So the blow up of them is going to be a 3 CP2s. But when I project to the T component, the CP2s go down into 0. So if I am in CP2 and I blow 3 points, I get 3 lines. But I added an extra parameter. So if I blow up the same 3 points, I get now 3 copies of CP2. But these copies of CP2, when I project them down, they don't project to the T factor, they project to 0. So that's where I get this image. So when I blow up this C cross CP2 at these 3 points and I look at the thing, what I'm going to get is a flat family of surfaces, which over 0, it will be 3 copies of projective space plus a copy of projective space blown up in the 3 points. And then for the other value, since I didn't do anything there because I blew up these points over 0, I get another copy of CP2. So I get this image, which is a flat family of surfaces, which for every point except 0 is a copy of CP2. And at over zero, I get this singular variety. Now, now if I consider from this blown up thing, the map, this regeneration of the Cremona map, then if I removed, so for t different from zero, it would be a branch 4-to-1 covering, and then from phi zero, when I restrict to each exceptional divisor, it will be an isomorphism, and when I restrict to this copy of the blown up of CP2, it will be the Cremona blow up. And so, and now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the foliation over here and pull it back. And so I immediately get an unfolding of the foliation, because it's a foliation of dimension 1, and I'm pulling it back by a map which is usually a submersion. I get a foliation of codimension 1, and every time I restrict to the FTs, I will get a foliation, and then over the value 0, I will get a copy which will be in each one of these copies an identical copy of the foliation over here, and over here I get a copy of the foliation blown up at the 3 points. So and then when I take something which is near, when I take a foliation here near, so that's where I see that these singularities here, which are concentrated on these intersection lines, will smoothen out to have this annulus. So this picture, when I apply it to the case of curves, it gives me the following result. Let C be a smooth curve of degree D in CP2 that intersects transversely this triangle. Then phi minus 1 of C is a smooth, so this is the inverse image of C by this map, this blown up map of the regeneration of the Cremona map, is a smooth surface, and the projection map is a fiber bundle over C minus 0 by smooth curves of degree 2D, and over 0 it consists of a curve having 4 irreducible components, each one isomorphic to C, each one located in one of these varieties having 3D ordinary double points. So that's the image for the case of curves. And so this is the image. I will have curves over here in each one of these projective spaces, and then when I arrive over here, I have 4 copies, and this map over here is 4-to-1, and when I arrive here to the parameter t equal to 0, is so it's an isomorphism on each one of these, and this is blowing down. And so here you have the picture. The thing is that, see, this picture is in some sense misleading, in the sense that here I'm not saying how this CP2 is approaching this thing over here. So in this other picture is more clear, in the sense that when you have this blown up thing, the CP2 is going to be coming in and coming in and coming in and coming in. So that's why you get this image, and that's how you get this image. And then, so the conclusion is this one that I mentioned before, that for applied to curves, you can understand how these fleas are appearing. And then for the case of foliation, we can also understand the foliation of degree 2D plus 1 is obtained from the original foliation of degree D by complicating the topology of the leaves, because we are gluing 4 leaves along tubes. So we are putting a lot of much more homology, one homology on the leaves, but it has the same holonomy maps. So the corollary is the topology of the leaves of FT is much more complicated than the topology of the leaves of F0, but they have equivalent pseudogroups. And so I also apply this for pencils of curves, but I think I'm going to skip this. So you can also do this for pencils. Instead of doing it for curves, you do it for pencils. And the idea is to try to understand what's the monodromy the monodromy of this pencil of curves that now will not be a Lefschetz a thing. And one of the things we were interested in is in, see, each one of these 4 components will have so this one is a copy of 4 copies, and then there are the tubes. And so the action of the monodromy group on each one of these is the same as the monodromy action. And so we wanted to figure out if it was still a simple a representation like it is for Lefschetz pencils. And so figuring out what happens at the tangencies of the pencil, we figured out that it was still simple. So thank you.
So, just a quick question. So, if you keep track of the singular points of the foliation after the Cremona transformation, what happens to it?
So, what happens is the following. So, the singular points of the transform of the Cremona map will be a singular point of multiplicity 7. And so, what comes out are 4 singular points of, I'm sorry, this is for the linear. The simplest case is to take a linear foliation and then do it. So what's going to come out in general is from each point you have another copy of CP2 with the foliation. You have as many singular points as the original foliation has coming out of the singular points, but plus you have some points which correspond to the tangencies of the foliation with the vertical planes. So, these new singularities will be Morse type singularities because they correspond to smooth points of the foliation and it's only corresponding to tangencies. So, assuming that you have simple tangencies with the vertical, this will give rise to new. So this corresponds, like in the other case, we had a copy of the Riemann surface and then we had the tubes.
Right.
And so the tubes correspond to the singularities of Morse type and the other ones correspond to the one that you made the inverse image. And these new singular points also, you have to keep track, that's why I mentioned, where it's branching. So where the branch locus is tangent to the foliation, we bring in new singular points. And you have to keep track of them.
What happens if you take all the elements of the Cremona group?
Excuse me?
What happens if you take all the...
Yeah, well, see. Yeah, you can repeat, you can take another triangle and repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat. And keep up. If I'm not mistaken, the Cremona group is generated by this elementary Cremona transformation. So if you apply, you can apply. So this means that you can get a curve of degree G into a very high degree with making all these kind of singular points. And what are going to happen is that when you perturb, out of each of these critical points, there will be another copy of G. Of the original curve coming out. So in that sense, you can iterate the procedure. So this is just the basic procedure applied to this one. And what I was wondering is how come something of degree D can be embedded into something of degree 2D while it's essentially the same? You know, that's what I want to understand.
Thank you.